talk about the tangle, which is a protocol, then talk about the stability, which is related to unconfirmed transactions, and then the parasit chain attack, which is one of the main attacks in the tangle, and the conclusion. So I'll jump right into the technical part. So everyone knows, I think, Bitcoin. That's why I will start with this illustration, which is the blockchain behind Bitcoin. Well, you know that so the data is stored in a chain of blocks, which are all chained by a preference like this. And so the main idea about Bitcoin is once in a while you randomly choose one node, and the probability to choose one node is proportional to the computational power of this node in the network. And then this node is responsible to append a block after the blockchain. So that's how the blockchain grows. So you choose randomly a node, it appends data, which is randomly done. That's it. And the blocks are limited in size. And usually there is one block every 10 minutes. So there is one main problem that I think everybody knows is that it does not scale well. That's one thing that IOTA and the Tangle tries to solve by replacing this chain of blocks by another kind of data structure. So the logic behind is quite similar, but we just replace this chain of blocks. So it's not technically a blockchain. So I will not talk about blockchain, but it's so similar that, and blockchain is used to represent all the distributed ledger technology usually. So this is usually called blockchain as well. So the Tangle. So here, a block doesn't store a bunch of transactions. Usually one block stores one transaction, so each transaction has its own block. And it does not reference one previous block, but it references two previous blocks. So if you append several transactions like this, in the end, you don't have a chain, but you have what's called a directed acyclic graph, which is a DAG. And that's the data structure behind the IOTA cryptocurrency. And that is called the Tangle. And so a little bit of vocabulary. So here you're not limited by bandwidth and storage, because everyone can just append whatever he wants to the data structure. So there is no limitation except from the network itself. And so the vertex of this graph are called sites. And a site that is not yet confirmed is called a tip. So it's the extremity of the Tangle. And so you see that here it's the transaction that confirmed previous transaction, and maybe in IOTA at least it corresponds to cryptocurrency transactions. So maybe it refers to a previous transaction that say, okay, the money I earned in this transaction, I will give it to someone else, etc. Yeah, we'll just talk about the data structure. And sometimes there are conflicting transactions. When a transaction confirms two previous transactions, it cannot confirm two conflicting transactions. So we will just reject this block if it's exactly like in Bitcoin. If Bitcoin, you use some Bitcoin that already were spent, everyone ignores the transaction. So. So how to read a value? In Bitcoin, you just read the whole blockchain. And here, you have to choose a tip, because maybe those two tips are conflicting. So you have to choose one tip, and then you just look at all the DAG that is behind, that is confirmed by this tip. And then you look at it, and there is no conflict in this DAG. So you can compute how much money everyone has in the network. But what if there are some conflicts between two sites? So then if you want to append a new transaction, you cannot confirm both tips. So you have to choose which one you will confirm. So that's a really important part of the protocol, how to choose between two conflicting transactions. Because if you choose, it means that you think that's one one is correct and the other is not correct. So you give really what, when you choose, you give a lot of information to the other. And the goal is that everyone agrees on the same thing, because that's how what we call consensus in the distributed systems in general. You have to, everyone has to agree on one value. If there is two possible value, everyone has to agree on one value. So the algorithm responsible to choose which tip will be selected to be confirmed is the fundamental block of the protocol. What can happen is that if some people choose to confirm this tip and the other choose to confirm this tip, then they cannot merge again, because if one transaction confirms both branch, then they will be conflicting, so it will be rejected. So in the end, we can have two subtangle, exactly like in Bitcoin, you can have two fork, and it's resolved somehow with some probability, but here it's actually the same thing. And so the algorithm responsible for choosing which transaction will be selected is called the tip selection algorithm. And so having this algorithm is really helpful to know how to read value, because you just run the algorithm and it will return the correct tip between the two. And so you know how to read the value. And it's also necessary to append new values. So if you want to append a new transaction to the network, you run the algorithm, it will tell you, okay, this is the correct tip that I want to extend. And then you know that you will append here the data. So it's really important. And actually in Bitcoin, it's actually similar. In Bitcoin, there is an algorithm to tell you where to append data. It's really a simple one. It just say that you take the longest chain, the one that generated the most amount of computational power. And so that's where you append data. And that's where you read the blockchain. Take the longest chain. Here it's, there is no easy algorithm. There are several algorithms, and that's what we will see now. There is several ways to extend the tangle. This is the tangle. Okay. And yeah, actually fork are not really a problem if there is no conflict. They are not even called forks in the tangle. But if there is a conflict, it's worse if the tangle looks like this. If there is two conflicting transactions here, it will be really a problem, because there will be two big subtangles that will be conflicting, and one of them will have to be discarded for the other. So one better picture is to have something like this, so that the number of tips remain almost constant, so that if there is a conflict, not so many transactions will be discarded, because that's something that we don't want to happen. And so, also, you don't want the transaction to go don't want people to extend the tangle everywhere in this chain. You want to force them in somehow to extend in one direction. So you want to append data, to append a new transaction, mostly here and not here, because otherwise this guy will be confirmed and it will be happy. And you don't want this guy to be happy, because otherwise lots of people will do the same, and the tangle will grow badly. So one thing that has been proposed in the white paper of Sergei Popov that described this tangle is that these tips should be selected with more probability. So if you have some probabilistic tip selection algorithm. And one way to do it is to assign the weight to each site. And so the weight of a site is one plus the number of sites that confirms it. So here there is five. But, and actually each transaction, there is a little proof of work associated with that, mostly to prevent spam. So it's, there is actually the weight give actually a sense of how much power has been used to generate this subtangle here. So there is a notion of weight here. And then you do random walk. So you start from the beginning, like this, and you do random walk until you reach a tip, and that will be the tip that you will choose. And you see that at every step you can walk toward a site that has some weight, and you will ignore, maybe will give less probability to move toward a site that has really small weight. So that's a nice approach. And so the probability is the exact probability to walk from this node, from this site to one of the two, or maybe more children, is by computing the difference of the weight, and then you apply a function. And the probability to move toward one child is proportional to the function of the difference. And so this function can be like exponential, can be exponential or just the power depending of on the delta. So here you see that the more the bigger the difference, the smaller the probability to choose this child. So, and the alpha is the parameter to play with the probability distribution. So, like if you take a really high alpha, then as soon as there is a small difference, here it's 4, here it's 3, then the random walk will almost surely choose the greatest difference. And if you choose a really small alpha, then since there is no so much difference between the two children, then they will have maybe the same probability to be selected. So, okay, so that. So then, how many tips are left behind? That's a notion of stability, because we saw that as soon as the number of tips remained almost constant, then it means that the network will behave better than if the tips are growing constantly. So we want something like this, and not something like this. Something like this can happen also, but we'll see later. And so to have a first analyze of this number of tips over the time, I will just do I started by a theoretical analysis, and it's not in the paper, but I've done also some simulation on other tip selection algorithms, but they are not used anymore, so it's not really, maybe I will do that part. So to start, I assume that the time is discrete, so there is this notion of a round, and every time there are some new transaction that arrives in the network. And so there is maybe a k transaction, and each transaction confirms two previous transactions. And so the important thing is to see how many tips there are over the time. Okay, so yeah. And so to analyze this number of tips, we have to do some probabilistic analysis. So at some point in time, we have n tips. And actually, this is called the state n in my paper. And so you have n tips, and we are looking at what happened when there is k new transaction. So on the other side, there is k new transaction that arrives. And this is like a famous a problem in mathematics, actually, not related to computer science. But it's like, so each new site will confirm two previous transactions. So it's like here I have two balls, and they are throwing the ball on the bins here. Okay. So right now we are assuming that the distribution is random. So they have the same probability. So it's really a first analysis to see how the network behaves with a simple algorithm. So here each transaction confirmed two previous transactions selected randomly, uniformly, among the previous ones. So it's exactly like they are throwing two balls randomly into the bins, and in the end you see how much bin have been have at least one ball, and how if there are some bins that don't have any balls in. And so in the end we want to see how much new tips there are, to see how the number of tips evolve over the time. So the number of tips is called n prime, so we will go from state n to state n prime. And n prime is actually k, because all those new tips will be unconfirmed tips in the next round, plus the number of bins that are empty. So all the tips that are not confirmed in this round will remain unconfirmed after. So that's the analysis. And to look at the probability from going to state n to state n prime, knowing that there is k new transaction. So maybe I will avoid the details, but it's just a simple probabilistic analysis. So we just count how many possible outcomes produce this new state, and times the probability of one outcome, since they are all like probable. So it's just the number of possible partition of the balls into the beans, times the number of ways you can arrange this partition, times the probability of one outcome. And that's the exact formula for this probability. And then you can look at, because that's for 1k. And then the k depends on the probabilistic Poisson distribution. So you have to compute for all the possible k the probability, and then you have this formula to go from state n to state m prime. That's the probability to move, and so you have a Markov chain with infinite number of states, and you know the probabilistic the probability transition to one set to the other. So you can compute the with arbitrary precision, because that's an infinite sum. What is the probability to evolve in this Markov chain? And that's the result. So if you take, for instance, the lambda, which is an average number of tips that is that are arriving every round, you see that the nice thing is that the distribution is stationary. So that means that over the, like if you just stay infinitely often in the network, the number of tips remains constant, and around like 120 tips. So that means that the stability is really nice, because there is always the same number of tips over the time. That's really a great property that was already known, but not by this kind of precision. And so we see that the exact number of, like if there is lambda transaction every round, then there is 1.255 and more times lambda tips in the network. In average in the network. So that's the exact value. Okay, so that was for the uniform random selection. But now what about this random work that are done to select more cleverly the new tips? And so I just did like some simulation, but they're not, maybe just to see that depending on the algorithm, we can have different number of tips. And here, there is a random here, which is constant. Some other probabilistic choice are constant, and lots of other way to choose, they generate a tangle that is growing, actually. So here, you just look at some, it's really important what the function are, but if you choose some function, the number of tips that are transactions that are never confirmed will grow like linearly, usually. So. And actually, last year, the algorithm that was used in IOTA was this one. So that's why there was a lot of unconfirmed transaction. But now that last year they changed to much better. It's not present here, but it's really close to constant right now. So yeah, much better. Okay, and that's what happened actually if you choose one of this bad algorithm. Like there are a lot of transactions that remain like this, and the tangle looks like that. Okay, now we will talk about the parasitic chain attack. So it's a double spending attack, so the most common way to attack a cryptocurrency, like Alice and then IOTA to Bob to buy a sandwich. Bob's way to see the transaction in the tangle, maybe what's some confirmation. Then Bob gives Alice the sandwich. Then Alice generates a lot of transactions so that her first transaction gets discarded, and then Alice eats the sandwich. Okay, so and still have the 10 iota. So she's happy. So how does it work in iota in the tangle? So you have to generate. It's like a fork in Bitcoin. So here you can have the attacker can choose actually the topology of his attack. So here the 10 iota to Bob, and here when Bob gives the sandwich, maybe like this, from here, and then Alice generates a lot of transactions to, and so here, like every node in the network just see this, maybe they say okay this is the correct tangle, so they will try to extend here, But at some point, maybe this will be more appealing to any honest node in the network, so they will start to choose to extend here. And so the important thing is how to create this parasite chain so that people start to think that this is the honest and this is not the correct one. So you can choose different topology. And actually, this is the best topology for the random uniform tip selection algorithm. So if every node chooses randomly, uniformly a previous transaction, then you just have to generate a lot of tips. And so any honest node will choose randomly, uniformly a tip. And so it has a greater probability to choose here and not here. So people will start to extend here and just ignore this subtangle. This is actually one of the best topology for the random walk selection algorithm, because you give a lot of weight to this particular node and a lot of children. So since the probability depends on the number of children, the number and the weight in the random walk, then you give a lot of probability. And again, there is a theoretical analysis just to prove again that if the algorithm depends on the weight, then as soon as Alice can generate more sight than the honest node, then Alice can generate a parasite chain to make double spend to make a double spending and to discard a tangle of any size. So that is how to extend that, to make a parasite chain. So you have to create a cut of the tangle and to generate a lot of sites, so that at some point every site that you add increase the weight of all this node of this site by one. So if you have more site than the honest node, then you can generate a subtangle that is better connected than this subtangle, and that has the same weight. So every time there is a random walk to select a new tip, so every honest node will do that. Arriving here, the probability to go to this parasite chain will be greater than to stay in the honest tangle. So every honest node will have a greater probability to extend here. And as soon as there are some honest node that choose the parasite chain, it will give even more weight to this subtangle, and everyone will switch to this parasite chain. And all the transactions here will be discarded, including the 10 iota to Bob. So one important thing and one important difference between Bitcoin and iota is that if the algorithm that selects the tips when you add the transaction depends on the weight of the site, then the security depends on the hashing power used by all the nodes. That means that how many sites there are in the honest tangle, and not in the hashing power of the network like in Bitcoin. In Bitcoin, you consider the hashing power of the network, and you say that an adversary can double spend if he has at least one half of the, in the most optimistic setting, one half of the hashing power of the network. Here, the important thing is that we have to consider the hashing power used by the node, which is really usually really less than the hashing power of the node. So, okay, that's just for the theoretical analysis. It's not really surprising, but it's important to model this this. And then usually it's in existing selection algorithm, it's even less than half. There are ways to create a parasite chain that even with a really small amount of transaction, you can create a chain that will be chosen by the honest one, and we think, okay, this chain is better, this tangle is better, and we'll all switch to this one. And so the important thing is how to evaluate, to measure what is the security of a given tip selection algorithm. And so we saw that with the random uniform selection algorithm, it was really bad, because with a small amount of new transaction, you can make a parasite chain that can break any honest chain. But with the other tip selection algorithm, we have to be maybe more clever. And so one kind of measure we can do is to look at how many sites do we need so that an honest agent will choose the parallel chain with probability greater than 1/2. Because as soon as you have this, that means that half of the network will follow you, and it means that you are creating a parallel chain. So the important thing here is to compute how many new sites you have to add in your parallel chain so that half of the network is following you and not the honest participant. So that's the factor that I called the security factor. It's not actually in this paper. It's in another paper, but it's really a following of what I did in this paper. Is to try to analyze the security by looking at really the parallel chain, and so there is a lot of work to do about the topology of this chain, how to attach the parallel chain. It's really important. It changes the result of the probability, so it's there are a lot of work to do in this, and that's my conclusion. So I remind that I tried to talk about the security of the tangle, not the IOTA, because IOTA used other security measure to counter this attack. They use central coordinator. But it's really important to see what are behind this protocol. So there are several questions that are left. So how to attach the parallel chain, how it impacts the security of the protocol, and what is the link between number of tips and resistance to parallel chain? Because in all the algorithms I looked until now, usually the stable one are sometimes the less secure one. And so maybe there is a link, maybe there is not. That's an open question and for my future work. And
okay, so thank you.
Thank you for your attention. And if you have a question, I'm happy to answer.
So I have a question.
Yes.
To start the questions. So do I understand correctly that no one so far has a result on IOTA which says, you know, given that the amount of resources that the attacker has is lower than something, then for sure this is secure?
No.
Okay. So here you're providing a analysis where everyone is honest except one particular Alice.
Yeah.
And Alice has a specific attack plan,
yeah.
And you're trying to, you know, explain how most efficient can it be made and things like this. Okay, it's interesting to know.
In statistical physics, there is a distinction between annulled disorder and quenched disorder. Mm-hmm. And in a lot of cases, quenched disorder, and so you have a tangle which is more quenched disorder.
Okay.
But there is very often that the result of quenched disorder are the same as annulled disorder. But I don't remember the...
I don't know. I'm sorry, I'm not familiar with this. I'm not familiar with this, but maybe it's something I have to look at. So thank you for the suggestion. Yeah.
I'm curious to know if the number of tips remains constant, as in the approach you described.
It depends on the...
Yeah, so suppose we use an algorithm that tends to a constant number of tips. Where is the conceptual advantage over a blockchain like Bitcoin? So we could see the tangle as having, essentially speaking, the structure of a standard chain.
Because then you are not limited by the size of the block. Anyone can just send their transaction in the tangle right away when they want. They just don't have to wait that someone validates its block. So it can have many advantages about like scalability like this. If there is more people sending transactions, then the tangle will grow. Maybe there will be a little bit more transaction, unconfirmed transaction, but it will remain constant. So one of the most important advantages is the scalability. And then we can see maybe other things that like the fact that there is the one that generates the block in Bitcoin decides. that are in the block may have some effect in about like the fairness of the how much time do I have to wait for that someone validate my transaction. So here you just throw your transaction, but some problem can appear because maybe no one will want to validate your transaction. So and also you can have two disconnected Tangle during a long period of time. Like if you have a small network become offline, you can still do transaction locally if you don't reference the recent transaction on the other side. And then if there is no conflict, you can merge really quickly the two Tangle. That's why it's called IOTA actually, because it's one of the goals is to be used in the IoT, where nodes can be disconnected or can work locally before merging two Tangles. That's, I think, one really important feature of this Tangle. Yeah. Yes.
My name is Daniel, and what I would like to ask is, as far as I understand, the tip set is not part of the consensus, so different nodes might perceive different sites being tips. And inherently, there's nothing is forcing you to actually attach to tips. You can attach to sites that have already been confirmed.
Yeah, exactly.
Have you considered those kind of strategies when building?
I have not, but actually, there is a paper about the equilibrium in the Tangle where they looked at what are the strategy to, like, if the majority of the people act like this, I have an advantage. Is there an advantage to not use the strategy and just attach anywhere? And they somehow show that it's better for everyone to follow this. It's not clear exactly if it's true for any strategy. If it's true for, so yeah. And actually, I don't know if it's really important. Like, if just lots of people decide to just append the site anywhere. I don't know what are really the problem. I think it's a complex question, and
Thank you.
I'd like to ask why was the Poisson distribution chosen as the assumed distribution of submitted transactions, and if this distribution changes, whether these results still hold?
For the stability, I looked with the really simplest algorithm like random uniform. I think the analysis will remain mostly the same. But this is a distribution that is used in networking, usually when you have an arrival of a transaction. That has been shown that it's really close to what happened in network in general with queue theory and stuff like that. So that's usually the first one we start to look at. It's a Poisson distribution when you have arrival of transaction. So, but I think most of the work will not change a lot if you choose different distribution, I think.
Quentin, thank you very much.
Thank you very much.